Welcome, I'm Ijeoma Onyato. Tonight, Nigeria's Chief Justice Mahmoud Mohamed criticizes the nation's political landscape, describing it as one that enables corruption to thrive through manipulation of the system. Judge in former NSA Sambo Dasuki's trial for alleged fraud, Justice Adeniyi Ademola, withdraws from the suit following allegations of bribery. The Senate asks President Buhari to conduct population and housing census in 2018. And Security Commissioner warns EU to prepare for returning jihadists in case Islamic State fighters are driven out of its Iraqi stronghold, Mosul.
On business news tonight, Nigeria's stock market falls for a second day as investors expect banks' third quarter earnings.
And on sports news tonight, FIFA's ethics committee suspends a former executive committee member, Warawe Makurdi of Thailand, for 5 years over election forgery.
And from Abuja, I'm Linda Akibe. Federal lawmakers hold public hearing on rescuing the airline industry from collapse. Federal government recommends concessioning of 4 international airport terminals to reposition the aviation sector.
We begin tonight from Abuja, where the Chief Justice of the Federation, Mr. Mahmoud Mohamed, has blamed the level of corruption in the country on the brand of democracy being practiced. He faults the nation's system, which gives unlimited powers to public officials through which they can shortchange the system. He, however, says that the problem is one that can be tackled with the collaboration of key players in the judicial and financial sectors. Our correspondent Amaka Okafor reports.
Judicial officers and members of the Chartered Institute of Bankers at the 16th National Seminar for Judges on Banking and Allied Matters. Also present at the event is the Chief Justice of Nigeria, Justice Mahmoud Mohamed. Joseph Kabul Rowling, Executive Secretary of the National Judicial Institute, is of the opinion that in view of the current economic realities in the country, there is a need for Nigeria to strengthen its intervention to curb the increasing cases of bad debt and other financial crimes.
A well-functioning legal system is essential to resolving the lingering problems of corporate governance and financial crimes in the banking industry.
For the Chief Justice of Nigeria, corruption and financial crimes have become woven in the fabric of the nation's governance systems. There is therefore the need for a holistic intervention across all sectors of the economy.
Our current political environment, though changing, also leaves public officials with wide, unrestricted authority, ill-defined powers and avenues for unjust enrichment, and the use of wide discretionary powers to manipulate the system. Curbing these financial crimes will only be possible if all stakeholders in the banking industry, judiciary included, play their roles effectively.
The national president of the Chartered Institute of Bankers, however, says the restructuring should start with making laws against financial crimes more stringent.
We will soon be approaching the National Assembly for necessary amendments to our extant law, the CIBN Act No. 5 of 2007.
Better laws and governance systems, participants at this event agree, is the way forward towards ridding the nation of corruption. Amaka Okafor, Channels Television News.
Meanwhile, the federal government has given law-abiding citizens the assurance that they have nothing to fear as its fight against corruption is aimed at retrieving the nation's stolen assets. Addressing participants at a national conference on the role of the legislature in the fight against corruption in Abuja, the Vice President, Professor Yemi Oshibajo, says corruption remains a threat to national development.
The issue of corruption again takes center stage as the Presidential Advisory Council Against Corruption and the National Assembly convene a conference to brainstorm on how to tackle the problem. The Vice President, who declared the conference open, laments the state of corruption in Nigeria.
Corruption is ultimately a fatal scourge. Many even argue that it is a crime against humanity. given the fact that in many countries, including ours, it is largely responsible for the abject poverty of the majority and the massive fatalities of the most vulnerable in our society.
A former director of the Kenya Anti-Corruption Commission in a keynote address recommends severe sanctions to deter corrupt persons.
Many African countries would have realized great economic and political growth, but such growth has been stunted because of corruption. Today, many of us know that the 50 odd African countries combined have a GDP that is lower than many European countries.
The chairman of the Presidential Advisory Committee Against Corruption berates the legislature for its failure to fight corruption, just as the president of the Senate advises the federal government to respect the rule of law.
The current low esteem in which the legislature, particularly the National Assembly, is held arises not from lack of legislative primacy, but by its exhibition of negative values and practices grossly against the interests of Nigeria and Nigerians.
I will not end my remarks without commenting on the need for every authority under our constitution to abide by decisions of the court made within jurisdiction. This is the only way to preserve law and order, maintain the rule of law, and an essential ingredient for the survival of our nascent democracy.
The two-day conference will, among other subjects, examine the role of the legislature as a champion of anti-corruption reforms, reform of the anti-corruption legal framework, and compliance with international standards.
To legal matters now, the trial judge in the case of alleged fraud against a former national security advisor, retired Colonel Sambo Dasuki, has withdrawn from the suit. Justice Adeniyi Ademola's withdrawal follows allegations that he obtained bribe from Colonel Dasuki. Justice Ademola was among the seven judges detained briefly about a week ago after the Department of State Services conducted searches and allegedly discovered several hundred thousands of dollars in his homes. Before announcing his withdrawal, Justice Ademola asked Colonel Dasuki if he had known him prior to the case and given him any money directly or through his lawyers, to which the former NSA replied in the negative. Meanwhile, Justice Iyang Okoro of the Supreme Court, who was arrested and detained by the Department of State Services also a week ago, has been speaking on why he believes he was included in the raid. He told the National Judicial Council that his arrest may be connected with a visit by the former governor of Rivers State and Minister of Transportation, Mr. Rotimi Amaechi, on February 1, 2016. He alleges Mr. Amaechi asked him to ensure that the APC candidate in the April 2015 governorship election in Akwa Ibom State, Mr. Umana Umana, wins all his appeals. In a four-page letter to the council, Justice Okoro claims the minister informed him that he sponsored the Akwa Ibom governorship candidate, and should he lose the elections, he, Mr. Amaechi, would have lost a fortune. Justice Okoro adds that the sum of $24,000 and €10,000 found in his house by the DSS are the accumulation of 3 years' travel and medical allowance since his elevation to the Supreme Court. In a swift response to that, the Minister of Transportation, Rotimi Amaechi, has described allegations made by Justice Okoro as a figment of his imagination made up to politicize the real issues for his arrest. In a statement this evening, Mr. Amaechi said he never approached Justice Okoro in respect of the cases mentioned or any other related matter. He describes the allegations as a cheap attempt to drag his name into something he knows nothing about. Away from that issue, the Senate has asked the President to issue a proclamation for the conduct of population and housing census in 2018. The lawmakers also asked the Secretary to the Government of the Federation, the National Population Commission and other relevant agencies to make adequate provision for the exercise in the 2018 budget.
The last time Nigeria held a census was in 2006. The last census was steeped in controversy with allegations of fraud, many Nigerians complaining of being left out of the exercise, as well as protests and enumerators complaining of not being paid for their work. Regardless, federal lawmakers are mindful of the importance of census to national planning and are asking the executive to abide by the recommendation of the United Nations that census be conducted every 10 years.
Concerned that in accordance with the best international practices, a well-planned and executed census population should take a minimum of 2 years to plan and execute. It is only pertinent that subsequent population census should be carried out with an adequate timing and objective of conducting acceptable exercise to the Nigerian people.
Some of the lawmakers also stressed the need for the provision of funds in the 2017 budget to aid planning for the census.
I think the fact that the next census was due this year, 2016, and the fact that it's even in 2018 that we plan to have that census in itself, you know, reveals the kind of attitude that we've always given to census. People must do the 2018 census, then ample provision has to be made in the 2017 budget. We don't have to wait to make this provision in 2018 budget.
The Deputy Senate President calls on relevant agencies to take advantage of the development in technology to conduct a credible census.
We must ensure that every Nigerian will be counted and nobody will be allowed through the application of technology to be counted more than once.
The Senate is also asking relevant committees to join the federal government in the planning towards the forthcoming population census to achieve a credible exercise. Linda Akibi, Channels Television News.
Let's take a look at what's happening in the education sector. Well, the Academic Staff Union of Universities has criticized the ongoing amendment of the Joint Admissions and Matriculations Board Act. ASU describes the process as erroneous and capable of hindering the development of universities in the country. The president of ASU, Professor Biodun Ogunyemi, stated this at a press conference on the state of the nation in Abuja. The union, however, commends the decision of the NUC to scrap pre-degree and diploma courses.
We understand that the Senate is amending the JAMB Act in some ways that contradicts the existing laws of the University Senate in the admission of students. Our union will resist this. If the parliament carries on with this erroneous initiative, the result will not only be negative in tempering with the global best practice in the admission process in Nigerian universities, but also diminish the status of the universities, which are currently facing challenges of being among the best in terms of ranking in the world. ASU therefore calls on the parliament to study the situation carefully and involve all relevant institutions and stakeholders who understand what it takes to address the problem of JAMB admissions and the first problems of limited access into Nigerian universities. Our union has argued repeatedly that the implementation of TSA is inimical to the well-being of our universities. Government must be educated on the workings of the university system. We've been trying to do that. It is not possible for administrators to run their relevant universities through the platform of TSA as its implementation has adversely affected endowments, scholarships, and management of research grants.
In part two, after the break, death toll from gunmen's weekend raid on Godogodo village in Kaduna state rises to 44. That's in a moment. Join us again.